Hello everyone, welcome on this e-learning platform of APEX Institute of Physics. In this video we will talk about conductors and their properties. Whatever the objects, physical objects that we look at, it is made up of, it is a material or substance. Now when we look at any material, it has a different material has the different properties. Now in materials, if we dig inside, we will find that there is going to be molecules, then atoms, then nucleus, then electrons. If we talk about the availability of electrons, so there are two types of electrons available in materials. One are those which are bound in the sense that they are orbiting around the nucleus and they are not free to move anywhere else. So such electrons are known as the bound electrons. And certain electrons, another type of that electron or certain electrons can be free. If there is a free electron, that means this can roam around inside the material and that's not bounded with the nucleus to move in the circular orbits. So most of the electrons are bound electrons, and in different materials the population of free electrons are different. Based on the availability and freedom of free electrons, we divide the materials in various types. So here we will talk about the types of material based on availability and freedom of free electrons. Now we can have a categories, these types as listed over here. This is a general categorization. In this, the first category we are talking about is insulators. So in case of insulators, we will find that these free electrons are not available. So no free electron is available. If there is no free electron, that means a charge cannot move inside the materials. Hence the material cannot allow these electrons are not there to move inside the material. Such a material is known as insulators. We can have example. If we look at example, we will find, let's say, a wood. Wood is in the category of insulator. You can have another thing like glass and other things, right? And second category is semiconductors. In semiconductors, there are certain amount of free electrons available. So that means a small amount of free electrons. So if a small amount of free electrons are available, so they are not in general or in normal conditions behave like a conductor. So but yes, these semiconductors are very important nowadays. For that sake, they have a different concept we need to learn later on, but at this moment we can think about the availability of free electrons are very feeble. And as of example, silicon is a good example of semiconductors. There are other examples like germanium as well. So this is the second category of material. The next category of material is a conductor, and that is the main topic we need to cover. In conductors, we have a plenty of free electrons available. So large amount of free electrons if available in a material, then these free electrons can move within the material and hence provide conductivity. So that's why they are known as conductors. And there are several examples for conductors. So all the metals are of this category. So if we talk about the metals, metals are conductors. For example, metals like copper, iron, gold, silver, these are all in the case of conductors. Normally these three categories are there in the type of material based on the free electrons. I have listed this fourth one as well. They are called superconductor. Superconductors are basically those conductors for which resistance is zero. So if there is no resistance for the movement of free electrons, then such a material is known as superconductors. Superconductors are basically characteristics of physical conditions of material. For instance, if we take mercury and bring it to a very low temperature like minus 180 degree, minus 190 degree, then you will find this will start behaving like a superconductor, and it will have no resistance to the flow of electrons. So these are the broad categories in which the material can be divided. In this chapter, our focus will remain with the conductors. So let's move ahead and talk about in detail other properties related to the conductors. So let's talk about the properties of a conductor or conductors. Here the properties that we are going to deal is basically related to the charge and field, that means electrostatic properties. So first important property is electric field inside a conductor is zero. So this is an important property, and what it means, let me explain it. It's, it says electric field inside a conductor is zero. So let me complete it first, is zero. Which means, let's say we got a conducting body, that is any metal. Whatever the field exists outside, it won't matter. But if we look at the field at any point inside, it's going to be zero. So electric field inside a conductor is always zero. So that's important property we need to remember. Next property is that when we give extra charge to a conductor, then it lies only on the surface. That could be written as free charge. Free charge lies on the surface of a conductor. On the surface of a conductor. Meaning is simple. Let's say this is a conductor and we are giving any charge to it, which is extra charge apart from this. So this charge will always reside only on the surface. That means the charge inside will be zero. So there will be zero charge residing inside a conductor. That's again an important feature. Now these two features are linked together. Now if we need to justify the second, we can justify the second using the first. Let's try to justify that. Now we know Gauss law. So if we use a Gauss law, so Gauss law says integration E dot ds for any Gaussian surface, this always is equal to charge enclosed upon epsilon naught. Now in case we take a Gaussian surface which is inside, completely inside the conductor, so at all the locations we will find the electric field is going to be zero. This will make left hand side to be zero. So for that Gaussian surface which is completely inside the conductor, Q enclosed will turn up to zero, which will say for any enclosed surface inside the conductor we will have a net charge zero. Since it is true for all the Gaussian surface, that means there is no charge existing inside. So whatever the charge a conductor carries, it carries only on the surface. Mind it, what we are talking about is a free charge. There are charges inside the conductor as well, but those charges are bound charges like bonded electrons and proton which is inside the nucleus, right? So that's an important feature or characteristic or property of a conductor. After learning these two important properties, we can move for the next one. Next one is about the field outside. So we can say electric field just outside the conductor is perpendicular to the surface. So that will let us know what is the direction of field just outside is. Let me re-explain this by drawing another picture. So let's say we are having this as a conductor, and if somebody asks about the field just outside, maybe let's say at this point. So at this point the field is going to be perpendicular to the surface. If it is, let's say, charged, positively charged, and the charge is Q. So here the field will be at 90 degree to that surface. Similarly, at any other point, it's going to be pointing perpendicular to the surface. So at all the points just outside, field is always perpendicular to the surface at that location. Right? So this is going to be 90 degree. Similarly, at this point or any other point, we will find there's going to be 90 degree. Moreover, we can add another point on this particular point. This is talking about the direction. Now if we are talking about the magnitude, so we can say magnitude is also fixed. So this magnitude of the field is magnitude of electric field. What at which point just outside the surface, that is given by E is equal to sigma upon epsilon naught. So that's important relation between density at any location and the field just outside. So just outside field is going to be sigma upon epsilon naught, where sigma is, that we know, is charge density. Charge density. Of course we know it's a charge density, but at which point? So at the point where we are talking about the field. So if we are talking about the field at this location, so at this location what the sigma is, we need to use that sigma and epsilon naught. So we can conclude by merging these two points. Here is the direction, here is the magnitude. So we can say the total field just outside can be written as sigma upon epsilon naught n cap, whereas n cap is indicating the direction normal to the surface. If sigma is positive, so this is outward direction. If sigma is negative, so it's an inward direction. So that becomes a formula to describe the field just outside a conductor or a metal. Next, go for the next property. So that the fourth property is about charge distribution. So we can say about this charge distribution that charge density, particularly surface charge density. So surface charge density, that we represent by sigma, is inversely proportional to radius of curvature. So sigma is proportional to 1 upon r at any location, and r is going to be radius of curvature at that location. So that's going to be radius of curvature. Obvious conclusion from here can be drawn that if the radius of curvature is uniform, then we will find charge density is uniform. That means charge is uniformly distributed. So that talks about the charge distribution on a conductor, because we know the charge is only on the surface. So we talk about the surface charge density, and that surface charge density depends on the radius of curvature. Let's say we are having this kind of conductor, and we can say if the charge this conductor carries, so that charge has to be on the surface. Now since this portion has a large radius, so there will be feeble charge located. Here the radius of curvature has become smaller, so here the charge density will be more. Similarly, here the charge density will be less. Similarly, here the charge density will find is going to be very, very dense. And rare, then it will be distributed like this. So point is, where the radius of curvature is more, charge density is less, so less charge will be distributed. That means in irregular shapes, charge will be distributed non-uniformly. Whereas if I draw a symmetrical surface, let's say this a spherical surface, let me make a bit thick. So in this case, if the charge has been given, what type of the charge distribution you can see? Can you guess what the kind of charge distribution is going to be? So here the radius of curvature is uniform at all the locations. So whatever the charge you are giving it, it will be uniformly distributed. So we can say if the radius of curvature is uniform, charge density is uniform, otherwise it varies. So that is an example of uniform charge distribution on the surface. That is an example of non-uniform charge distribution on that surface, and the relation how the charge distribution is given by this expression. So this is again an important property that we frequently use whenever need arises. Let's go for the next property of the conductor and learn that. It talks about the potential of a conductor. Now this entire conductor, since the field inside the conductor is zero, so we can say there will be no potential difference between any two points. So we can say a conductor behaves like equipotential region. So we can say a conductor is an equipotential region, equipotential region. So whatever the space a conductor occupies, it carries same potential at all the locations. And just to explain it, let's say this is a conductor, or let me make another picture. This is a conductor. So if somebody asks what is the potential difference, let's say between two points, point number one, point number two. So what we can claim that the potential of one is equal to potential of two as per this rule. Hence the potential difference between one two point is going to be zero. Why so? I just explained, because the field inside is zero and we know potential difference is integration E dot dr, so E is zero, so potential difference is zero. So we say this is valid both ways, so potential difference is zero and the potential is equal. So all the points of a conductor are equipotential. So this is another important property that has been used in examination many a time. They might ask in a different, little different way. They might ask, like, say this is a conductor, if we move any charge from one location to two locations, so how much the work done is going to be. We know work done by electrostatic force is going to be equal to Q into change in potential, right? So if change in potential is zero, that means the work done is going to be zero. That means if we bring any charge from one location to two location, or from any location to any location in a conductor, you will require no work done simply because it's equipotential region. So that's an important property to be understood and remember. Let us move to the next property. So sixth property is about electrostatic pressure. So this says electrostatic pressure is given by, so let's call it as by PP for pressure, and this pressure is half epsilon naught E square, half epsilon naught E square, where E is the field, net field, just outside the conductor. So let's justify how this is coming and what it means. So let's say that is a formula. We will treat it as a formula now onwards. Let's say we are having this conductor, any conductor for that matter, and we know the field inside is zero. This is a solid body, and we know the field just outside is sigma upon epsilon naught. If it has been given any charge, charge resides outside. Now if we consider any segment of the surface, let's say we are considering this small surface. On this small surface, if we draw that small surface, let's say separately, then we will find this will carry certain charge dq because of the charge distribution on the surface, and there will be zero field just inside. The field just outside is sigma upon epsilon naught. But whatever the field just inside and just outside in this case is, that is because of the all the charge distribution, including this dq as well. Now this segment, let's say this carries a surface area ds, how much this force will be experiencing, it will depend how much the field is here at this location because of the rest of the charge, because of the rest of the charge, right? So we can say if it is a pinhole, then this is a very small segment, so we can consider that's a very small area, so that's like a pinhole. Inside field is zero, outside field is sigma upon epsilon naught. So what the field at this location where this dq charge is going to be? We have talked earlier that at that location the field is going to be equal to field just inside plus field just outside by 2. That means average field. Now we know the field just inside is 0 and just outside is a sigma upon epsilon naught, and that is in the normal direction, divide by 2. Using this we can find out that the field on which this segment of ds is existing is equal to sigma upon 2 epsilon naught in the normal direction. If this is the field on which this dq charge is located, then we can say this must be subjected with a force F, or we can say this force F, or you can call it as a df force because it is acting on this small segment. This force is going to be equal to dq into E, the field on which this charge has been placed. Then we know how the pressure is defined. Can we say this pressure is defined as df by ds, the force and area. Now we can say this force is perpendicular to the surface, so this is a perpendicular force. As per the definition of pressure, we need to use the force perpendicular divided by area. So this given force is already a perpendicular force, so we can put that value over there. So it becomes sigma upon 2 epsilon naught, that's the magnitude which is perpendicular, divided by ds, and there was a dq as well because of this this dq, which we can write it as a sigma upon 2 epsilon naught in bracket dq upon ds. Can we say this dq upon ds is going to indicate the charge per unit area, that is a surface charge density, which is sigma. We are calling it as a sigma. So this pressure is coming as sigma square upon 2 epsilon naught. 2 epsilon naught. Well, so that's the pressure formula. So from here we got a formula that this electrostatic pressure the surface of a conductor is sigma square upon 2 epsilon naught. An important result or formula we should remember. Now this can be converted in this format that we have already written earlier. We know if the field is E, now we are writing the net field, the total field which is just outside, right? So we can say the field is given by, we can use that field over here, this field is sigma upon epsilon naught, the field just outside. Here we are using the field which is just outside, or you can call the field outside, just outside. This E is a different than the E that we have used here. Let's call this E as E prime. So I'm using here E as E prime, and that E prime is a different than this. E prime is the field on which this charge dq was located, right? So this net field E is going to be this. From here we can calculate the value of charge density, which is going to be epsilon naught into E. We can substitute to this formula, value of sigma. This will indicate the pressure, electrostatic pressure is going to be epsilon naught E whole square divided by 2 epsilon naught, which gets converted into this square, right? So this gets converted into half epsilon naught e square. And that's this formula I have listed over here. So here is the kind of proof how we are getting this electrostatic pressure. So this is electrostatic pressure because of a charged conductor on the surface. Or we can say this is a general formula: wherever there is a field E, then the electrostatic pressure is half epsilon naught E square. Another important property to be understood and remembered.